Amen. Well, good morning to you. Hope you had a good Merry Christmas. Everyone having a good Christmas yesterday? Good. Some of you look very full with Christmas treats and goodies and desserts and turkeys and hams and smoked meats and all those things. And so I hope you had a good day yesterday with loved ones or family. It's good to see you. I'm glad you're here on the day that is now the farthest day away from next Christmas. And I think I saw something online this morning as I was just kind of getting up and getting ready. For some people, today is the saddest day of the year because you have the longest amount of time to wait till next Christmas. I mean, it can't get more longer than it is right now to wait till next Christmas. But here's what I do know, if you have a little bit of Christmas hangover, if you'll allow me to use that term, I do know that the Lord is good and that the Lord is risen and that we're going to celebrate Him today and worship Him and read God's Word and study it this morning. Amen? So I'm glad you're here on the Sunday, the day after Christmas. Next year, Sunday actually is on Christmas, which I think will be a lot of fun. I'm glad you're here today. Go ahead and turn your Bibles to Proverbs chapter 4, which will be our main sermon text this morning, and then we'll spend a little time in Matthew chapter 15, kind of toward the end of the message. But our main kind of springboard text is Proverbs chapter 4. Well, raise your hand if you've ever used the term game changer before. Do you ever use the term game changer before? So a couple of you good. You know, I feel like I was trying to think of what would be like game changers in someone's life. You know, there obviously are several different things that could be a game changer in someone's life. The thing that probably came to my mind first was thinking when you go from having one child to having two children. Is anybody with me this morning? I understand it's the day after Christmas. Anybody awake out there? Going from one kid to two kids is a game changer. When you have one kid, for those of you who have been blessed to have children, me and my wife, we have two little blessings. We have two kids, and so when you go from you have one kid, man, you're in zone coverage. All right, it's two against one. So one of you can be with the child, with the baby, you know, watching it, you know, feeding it milk, taking care of it, doing things that children need. And the other one can be doing other tasks. You could be cleaning the house. You could be resting. You could be taking a nap. You could be doing things that would be productive or doing things that wouldn't be productive. I don't know. You could be doing whatever you want. When you go from one child to two, you're not in zone coverage anymore. You're in man-to-man coverage, right? You're two on two. Your things might get a little hairy. Things might get a little different. Now, one of you is with the newborn, the child, the baby, and you're taking care of it and doing all the things that babies need. And the other one is with the toddler, and you're watching movies, and you're playing Barbies, and you're playing dolls, and you're having fun. You're playing, race cars and all these different things. You're now in man-to-man coverage. Now, for those of you who have been blessed with three or more children, man, you guys are just outmanned and outgunned, and you're just trying not to drown. Amen. But going from, I think, one kid to two, to me, just in my life, my experience, that has been a game changer. Our oldest, Emma, she's about to turn 4 in February, and Addie, she just celebrated her one-year birthday in August. But going from one kid to two, man, that's a game changer. Webster's Dictionary defines game changer as a newly introduced element or factor that changes an existing situation or activity in a significant way. Simply put, there are moments in all of our lives that redefine an outcome. There are moments in all of our lives that redefine an outcome. For some of you this morning will be a newly introduced element that has the power to change you. The power of God's word, power of corporate worship, power of gospel-centered preaching. For those of you, it's my prayer that this morning will be in an experience like an aha type of moment that will redefine an outcome for you. And those are some big hopes. So let's dive into this morning's primary text, Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23. Just one verse this morning for the day after Christmas. And I probably should hear an amen for that. Just one verse. We're just gonna tackle it together. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23. And just for this morning, I'm reading out of the New Living Translation, just because I think it helps for the message we're trying to tackle. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23. Guard your heart above all else, for it determines the course of your life. Guard your heart above all else, for it determines the course of your life. This one proverb contains 14 game-changing words, but I'm most captured with the three words, above all else. If you're the type of person who underlines things in your Bible or highlights things in your Bible, which I would encourage you to be that type of person, I am that type of person, I would encourage you to underline or highlight those three words, above all else. The scripture is referring to our spiritual heart, which is quite different than our physical blood-pumping heart. But the similarities between the two hearts are too obvious to ignore. With a physical heart, you obviously can't see it, but it is essential to living. It works behind the scenes to keep your body running. You've seen it pulsating inside an open chest on the Health Channel, right? You can't live without a heart. You can, however, live without a limb. Did you know that? Anybody ever seen the movie 127 Hours? It seemed like it takes 127 hours to watch that film. It's so long. But James Franco, it's a true story, by the way. James Franco portrays this mountain climber who gets caught in these cliffs, in these mountains, in these ridges, and he has to cut off his own arm and hike out to safety. So, first lesson from this morning, an arm, it's a nice perk, right? I mean, it's nice to have. It's not 100% necessary. I know of an NCAA Division I wrestler, champion wrestler, who has wrestled with one leg. And it's amazing to watch him wrestle, missing a limb, and he's still dominant, and he's still a champion wrestler. Limbs, they're totally negotiable. A heart, that's totally essential. When it comes to your spiritual life, your heart is the game changer because it determines the course of your life. If you don't have much concern about your spiritual life, or maybe you're unsure, maybe this morning's your first Sunday at Ankeny Free Church, maybe in church in general or in a while, man, I'm so glad you're here. Maybe you're just checking it out. Regardless of your faith intent, this is a statement that might have something of value for you, and it's this. For those of us who have put our faith in Jesus Christ, this heart emphasis is huge. This emphasis on a spiritually changed heart is huge. Our bodies are very complex, but there are some extremely predictable happenings within the human body. For example, for those of you who eat sausages like it's an Olympic event, and you keep eating sausages, you're going to probably see the doctor and then most likely the morgue at the end of the day. It's very predictable. When the heart is bad, when it's diseased, when it's unhealthy, it reveals itself in noticeable ways. You have shortness of breath. You have a lack of energy. You have numbness, and you have a tightness in your chest. Those are just some of the kind of the general symptoms of an unhealthy heart, a heart that's diseased or a heart that's bad. And there are specific signs of an unhealthy heart. But with your spiritual heart, if you have a weak spiritual heart, did you know that it'll also show some symptoms? Here are some symptoms of a weak spiritual heart. You won't have a shortness of breath, but you'll have a shortness of love. You won't lack energy. You'll lack compassion. There won't be tightness in your chest, but there'll be a tightness in your generosity. And you won't feel physical numbness, but you'll be numb to God's presence. And if you really want to evaluate, friends, the spiritual condition of your heart, watch what happens when things don't go your way. When some pressure squeezes in on your life. When you're not the most comfortable in a situation or in a conversation or in something that's going on. Watch what symptoms from your spiritual heart show up when you feel some pressure, when you feel some squeeze, when you feel some uncomfortability. I don't even know if that's a word. Maybe it is. I don't care. We're going to go with it. For me, when I start my day, my life is easy. Did you know that? My life is easy, breezy, beautiful, but it's not CoverGirl. My life is great, right? I wake up, I get some coffee, I spend some time with the Lord, my wife and my children wake up and they just love on me. My wife comes to me and says, oh husband, she gives me a kiss. What can I make you for breakfast, sweetie? It's fantastic, right? My children just want to hug on me, say, oh father, give us more wisdom to how to live right and how to walk with the Lord. And I give them biblical instruction from God's word. Amen. And they listen perfectly and without waiting even a nanosecond. It's fantastic. I kiss my family goodbye. I drive up here to Ankeny. I kind of live in Sailor Township area, so I'm on my way up here. I get in my car. I start singing worship songs like, I love you, Lord, right? There's a reason why I'm not on the worship team. Amen. I start singing worship songs in my car. I'm driving down my street. I'm looking at the birds. I'm amused by the bunnies. I'm driving through my neighborhood. I'm waving at my neighbors and their 2.5 children, right? Life couldn't be better. I'm essentially Mr. Rogers without the sweater, and life is good in my neighborhood. But after about 7 minutes of driving, usually, it's usually when I hit aura labor over here, the car behind me honks because I didn't hit the accelerator the nanosecond the light turned green. Is anybody with me this morning? I see that hand in the back. Thank you. And not only does the light turn green in that moment, but I also turn green. And I turn into the angry Incredible Hulk. And I get mad. And my heart reveals anger, and I just want to lean out my window and yell, give me a break, you jerk, right? And I can move from Jesus Jr. to Judas with the sound of a honk. And instead of waving and mouthing, Jesus loves you, and blowing a kiss to them from my window, you know what I do? Maybe this is just a confession time this morning. I'm not sure. You know what I do? I go super slow through the intersection and make them drive behind me. Is anybody with me this morning? I'm not saying this is right, wrong, or indifferent, but that's just what I do sometimes. And I just get that honker so ticked off at me, and it works, and he flies around me. And he, you know, he gestures some really nice hand gesture at me out his window. It's really nice. And he cuts me off with this black Mercedes with the bumper car that says visualize world peace, right? And I smile because I've won. And then I go back to singing, I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice, right? Where did that anger burst come from? It came from my heart. I've got some anger plaque built up that's affecting my heart, my spiritual life. That plaque, number one, it slows down my love for people. The residue clogs my spiritual growth. And it pollinates my bloodstream, so anger is slowly flowing through me just below the surface. And here's what I know. I'm not alone, am I? Amen. I hear that. Thank you very much. When Jesus spoke of the heart, he used a lot of game-changing words. And let's take a deeper look in Matthew chapter 15. We're going to be spending the rest of our time there. Matthew chapter 15, we're just going to be working through some of these verses in that passage. Matthew chapter 15, starting in verse 1. I'm just going to read the first two, and then we're going to take verse-by-verse chunks. Matthew 15, beginning in verse 1. Then Pharisees and scribes came to Jesus from Jerusalem and said, "Why do your disciples break through tradition of the elders? For they do not wash their hands when they eat." A Pharisee was someone who was distinguished by strict observance to the Jewish religious laws. And the context, friends, of this text was a common scene, really, for Jesus. The religious leaders tried to catch Jesus saying something that would be worthy of allegations, and they wanted to get Jesus to admit to breaking the law so that they could discredit Jesus to the masses, to the people. But Jesus didn't break God's law, but he didn't keep the human-made rules that these religious leaders had created so that these people wouldn't break God's law. Like, if over there that wall is the threshold of breaking God's law, these Pharisees and scribes and religious leaders would insert speed bump and stop sign and yield sign and 5 mile per hour road signs to stop people from eventually breaking God's law. And they would give these religious, do these things, the things that weren't found anywhere in God's word, things that weren't found anywhere in the Mosaic law, and this kind of kept people from getting even close to breaking God's real laws, and they kind of deified these laws and made them holy. And unfortunately, guys, I don't know if you know this, that's still happening today. When I was a teenager, I remember an older lady from my church telling me that Christians shouldn't play cards. Now, she told me this, is that me and my friends, I was dealing them a hand of cards as we were standing in the church parking lot waiting for the church vans to take us to camp, right? But she thought that Christians shouldn't gamble. And since cards are the gateway drug to gambling, right? She thought we should stop playing cards. Good Christians who love Jesus shouldn't touch cards, shouldn't play cards, shouldn't go to places that you can play cards. So go fish. Bad, right? Crazy eights. Demonic. Amen? And don't even get me started with Uno now. Uno is a no-no, right? Can I watch the World Series of Poker on my TV? Well, she would say, yes, as long as you close your eyes during the Powerball commercials. We can get away around that. Back to the Pharisees' hand-washing question. In the Old Testament, God instructed the priests to stay ceremonially cleansed. You can see Leviticus 22 for this. And every time the priests ate, they were supposed to wash their selves from the tip of their fingers down to their elbows so that to keep anything impure from entering into their mouths and defiling them. And as time went by, these religious leaders decided that everyone should be doing this, not just the priests. So they came up with a tradition of ceremonial hand washing for everyone. But Jesus didn't go along with these human traditions. He said, people, you're missing the big picture. You're focused on clean hands when instead you should be focused on clean hearts. Matthew chapter 15, jumping down to verse 7. Jesus says, "You hypocrites! Well, did Isaiah prophesy of you when he said, 'This people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men.'" That word hypocrite has its origin in Greek theater, and it's describing the character in the play or the performance who would wear a mask to cover their identity. And Jesus essentially is calling these people spiritual phonies. And they pretend their heart is near to God, but in reality, it's very distant. Empty ritualism does not bring intimacy with God. And then Jesus gets their hand-washing protest, verse 17. "Do you not see that whatever goes into the mouth passes into the stomach and is expelled?" And Jesus is addressing just basic human body function chemistry here. You know, you eat something and it's going to eliminate itself. Now, I'm a youth pastor. I know there's a tremendous opportunity here to make a potty joke. But friends, let me tell you something right now. I will never squat that low, okay? I won't do it. I refuse to. I won't go there. Verse 18, Matthew chapter 15. But what comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart, and this defiles a person. In your spiritual life, it's not dirty hands that defile you. It's what comes out of your mouth that defiles you. Why? Because the answer brings us to our game changer, and it's this: what comes out of your mouth was birthed and grew in your heart. What comes out of your mouth was birthed and then grew in your heart. When you say something hurtful, when you say something mean, when you say something derogatory, maybe when you say something racist or sexist, and then you say, "Ah, I didn't really mean to say that, I'm sorry." Most likely what you really mean, or maybe what's closer to the truth, is, "I didn't mean to say that out loud." You know, you've seen that before. They act all surprised. Where did that come from? Oops, my goodness. How did I let that slip through? And God says, "I do. I know it came from your heart. And you've just got really good at covering it up, but I know what your heart really looks like." Guys, we can fool other people all day long, can't we? We can. Some people do it all the time. Some people have been faking how they act, who they are, for years. But we can never fool God. Hebrews 4:13, "And no creature is hidden from his sight, but all are naked and exposed to the eyes of him to whom we must give an account." God sees it all. He sees the heart. He has access to the heart because he embodies the heart of those who walk with Jesus. You can fool other people 24/7, but before God, he sees it all. Your heart is naked and exposed. Jumping back into Matthew 15, verse 19. "For from the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, all sexual immorality, theft, lying, and slander. These are what defile you. Eating with unwashed hands will never defile you." That's quite the list, isn't it? From the heart comes evil thoughts. Murder flows from anger stored in our heart. Adultery, sexual immorality, flows from lust stored in our heart. Theft flows from greed that's stored in our heart. Lying flows from deception that's stored in our heart. Slander flows from jealousy that's stored in our heart. And it's very clear that Jesus teaches the game changer is your spiritual heart. It's command central for all of your actions. Parents, if you have kids still living with you at home, or maybe your kids have grown up and they've moved out, regardless, when you look at words or actions as the tell-all sign for your child's morality, like, "Oh, don't use that word," or just don't do that, I'm hoping that you don't miss the bigger picture at play here, and that is real heart change. We don't just want to put on a be a good boy or be a good girl band-aid on sin. Just cover it up, don't, you know, out of sight, out of mind. We want to address the issue that's deep down, the root of the problem, and that's a heart that needs changed by Jesus. Amen? I've been a youth pastor for 7 years, and I've experienced parents dropping their kids off for a youth group, and in essence, they're just saying, "Fix him, adjust his behavior. He needs church. Have him baptized, have him sanctified, have him dry cleaned, and I'll pick him up when he's 18. Essentially, they're just saying this: "Just change his behavior, JD. Fix him. I can't deal with him anymore." And I want to say this. You want behavior change. We all do in our kids. But what we really should be looking for and praying for and wanting and trying to have happen is a heart transplant that only Jesus can perform. You know, it's not a pot-smoking, beer-drinking, lion-cussing issue. It's a heart issue. You with me? And those actions are merely just symptoms of a heart in need of change. God is not a glorified etiquette modifier or instructor. God's not looking for behavior modification. He's looking to change everyone's heart from the inside out. And the inner life of a person is a big deal to Jesus. How do I know that? Because Matthew chapter 23 tells me. You don't have to turn there. I'm just going to read Matthew chapter 23, verses 25 through 28. It says this: "What sorrow awaits you teachers of religious law and you Pharisees, hypocrites! For you are so careful to clean the outside of the cup and the dish, but inside you are filthy, full of greed and self-indulgence, you blind Pharisee. First wash the inside of the cup and the dish, and then the outside will become clean too. What sorrow awaits you teachers of religious law and you Pharisees, hypocrites!" Jesus says it again. "For you are like whitewashed tombs, beautiful on the outside, but filled on the inside with dead people's bones and all sorts of impurities." Outwardly, Jesus is saying, you guys look like religious people who have it all together, but inwardly, your hearts are filled with hypocrisy and lawlessness. Matthew chapter 23, verses 25 through 28 doesn't sound like the Jesus I heard about in second grade that's walking through the flower field, picking flowers and holding children. Jesus knows how to kick some tail and take in names when he needs to, right? He does that right here with these Pharisees and scribes. In biblical times, tombs were regularly washed clean to make them stand out. And they were spectacular. They were almost ornate. They were beautiful. And these religious leaders who looked so good on the outside, they had all the boxes checked of the great person who follows the Lord. They will do all these things. But they actually were dead on the inside. They needed a Jesus beatdown. I've always wanted to preach a sermon like people who just need slapped. you ever think about that? Like not beaten up, not injured, just a nice slapping, right? Just a nice slap. I have a couple examples of that. People who wear Bluetooth earpieces at dinner with their family, slap. What are you doing? Come on, be with your family. No call is that important. Here's another one. People who put clothes on their dogs, come on. What are you doing? Slap. What's going on here? Some of you are like, hey, they're talking about you. I see those nudges around the room. People who push their dogs in strollers, what have we come to in society that we're pushing animals in strollers? And then here's the worst one. Any adult wearing Crocs, slap, come on, get it together. Some of you might be wearing Crocs right now. I don't know, maybe you got Crocs yesterday for Christmas. Who knows? Why was Jesus so heated in Matthew 23? And here's what I want us to get so badly this morning. Because Jesus knew an unclean heart wreaks havoc in our lives, and it ruins our relationships. I'm going to say that again. Jesus knows that an unclean heart, an unhealthy spiritual heart, wreaks havoc in our lives and in our relationships with people. So is there any hope for the human heart? Well, based on what the Bible says about God, let me tell you this. Ezekiel chapter 36, verse 26. "And I will give you a new heart, and I will put a new spirit in you, and I will take out your stony, stubborn heart and give you a tender, responsive heart." In this verse, Ezekiel was writing to the nation of Israel who's in exile, and they're no longer living in the land that God had promised them, and he's giving them hope for the future and describing the character and capabilities of God. And this very theology is all over our New Testament. A new, transformed, changed heart is what God does. And so I say, yes, 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 there is hope for the human heart. There is hope for your sinful hearts. There is hope for my sinful, wretched heart. When your heart is changed, your desires change, and when your desires change, that determines the course of your life. And so here's the key. You don't change your spiritual heart. God does. He does the impossible, then in cooperation with the Spirit within you, you do the possible. It's a teamwork. It's a partnership. It's a process. Galatians chapter 4, verse 6 says this: "And because we are his children, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, prompting us to call out, Abba, Father." God's Spirit is at work within you, confirming that you are adopted into God's family, Romans chapter 8. And there's a loving, divine, paternal relationship happening. And Abba is an Aramaic term of endearment, meaning daddy. And so essentially, God is saying, I got this, kid. I got the big stuff. I'll do the heart surgery. You just do your part. And so let's just get practical as we end by what I mean by our part or your part. A few primary symptoms of the spiritual heart disease that many of us suffer from, right? Spiritual heart disease, is three things, and I've kind of broken this down into three categories. If you're taking notes, write these three things down. Anger, greed, and jealousy. Anger, greed, and jealousy. Can anyone relate to any one of those? If your hand's not raised, you can at least relate to lying, okay? So we've at least taken care of that this morning. So if you've written those three things down, anger, greed, and jealousy, now in your notes, under those, or next to them, or whatever, draw a line from anger and write forgive. Draw a line from greed and write give. And then draw a line from jealousy and then write celebrate. And these are a few exercises to improve our spiritual heart condition. It's forgive, it's give, and it's celebrate. And if you're thinking, well, jealousy, that's me. I get so jealous. I don't like rich people. I don't like pretty people. I come to Ankeny Free Church. I drive through the parking lot, and I see a super nice vehicle, and I just get mad, and jealousy bubbles up, right? Jesus, remove this jealousy from my heart. Jesus would say this, I'm working on your heart. Now do your part. Jealousy over this new car or that promotion or that new boat or that cool new house, here's what you need to do. You need to celebrate that person's achievement. You need to celebrate that person's new car. You need to celebrate that promotion that so-and-so got. You need to celebrate that cool new vacation home that they got. You need to celebrate that new boat. Whatever it is, you need to celebrate with that person. And maybe you're saying this, well, that wouldn't be genuine. I'd be faking it the whole time. Jesus says this, I know because your heart is diseased and we're working on it and my spirit is at work in your life, like I promised, but you need to start celebrating people. You're always comparing yourself to others because you don't understand my love for you. That's what Jesus would say. So go celebrate people who cause you jealousy. Every day, do some uncomfortable, courageous stuff like forgive. Give, and then celebrate, and make those daily exercises. Just like you do things, at least you should, to keep your physical heart healthy. Guys, we need to do some things to keep our spiritual hearts healthy as well. God's promised to take up residency with his spirit and dwell within us, Ephesians chapter 3, then Christ will make his home in your hearts as you trust in him. Let us have four things that we can walk through quickly. These are just kind of statements. Number one, Jesus prompts us through his spirit to have a heart more aligned with Christ. Number two, Jesus provides opportunities for us to be with other like-minded people who are caring about their heart's condition. Let me encourage you with this. If you are in a community group right now here at Ankeny Free Church, let me encourage you to make that your goal before February ends of 2022 to get in a community group. Because being in a community group around like-minded people who are generally in the same season of life as you, same stage of life as you, that is life-giving for you. And those people can speak truth into your life and vice versa for you to them, and that you can grow closer to the Lord together. Get in a community group. Number three, Jesus gives us his word to know how to walk and follow him in heart-shaping ways. Do you have a strong devotional life? Do you have a strong scripture-reading pattern in your life? If you don't, hop on the Walking in the Word plan. The stuff's on the handouts in the back. Grab that. We can start walking with the Lord together in his word, reading one passage of day, praying for a little time every day, and praying for one person who needs prayer every day together. And then fourthly, Jesus speaks through this collective assembly of people every weekend. Make church a priority in 2022. I'm not big on New Year's resolutions. Sometimes I think they do more harm than good. But thinking about new starts, fresh years, just new beginnings, decide to make church a priority. Decide to be here on Sunday mornings. Decide to serve. Decide to give. Decide to be involved. I hear people all the time, well, I feel like I go to church and I don't know anybody. And I'll be like, yeah, you're right, because no one knows you, because the second the service ends, you bolt out the door to head off to something else. Be involved in this family, in this body. Be invested with your time, with your finances, and with your prayer. And there are many other prompters to help us do our part. No doctor can force you to get your heart into shape, and your Heavenly Father has chosen not to force you either. He's loving you and cheering you on, knowing that a healthy, growing, robust, spiritually God-infused heart will determine the course of your life. And as the worship team comes, during our response time, friends, I want to encourage you with this. Don't check out. Listen. I want to encourage you to talk to God during this last song about this partnership that you have with Him when it comes to your spiritual heart. Confess maybe some areas in your life that you know that need to be changed, need to be addressed, and commit to doing your part. It's more than just, God, change me, make me a better Christian. No, there's some work that goes along with that. There's some commitments. There's some things that need done. There's some praying that needs to happen. Next week, we start our new sermon series in Ecclesiastes. I'm looking forward to that. Hopefully you, January 2nd, start the new year off in church, just like we're ending the year in church. I'm glad you're here. Guys, I can't tell you enough, I've been so convicted by this passage and message this week, how the state and condition of our spiritual heart truly is a game changer in our lives. Thanks for being in church today. Let me pray, and the worship team is going to lead us in our last song. Father God, thank you for this time to learn, to read, to pray, to laugh a little bit, to sing, to be with friends. Lord, as we enter now into this time of worship, Father, help us to ponder the things we just talked about. Help us to process maybe the spiritual condition of our heart. Maybe it needs to be worked on. Maybe there needs to be some spiritual workouts to help some things along. Maybe there needs to be some things confessed. Lord, you know what those things are. Father, help us to take care of those things even today. If there's someone we need to forgive, Father, help us to do that. If there's some areas where we need to celebrate others or give. Father, help us to think about those things and make wise choices. Lord, thank you for this time. Thank you for those who are here. Father, thank you just for the blessing it is to be together. And Lord, be with us now as we enter this time. All God's people said, amen. Amen.